Welcome, I'm Charlie. I took the training in 1974. In fact, I gave the training in 1974. And I've met many of the almost 20,000 volunteers who have gone through this training. That's a lot of years and a lot of people. And the question that keeps coming up is the one that Kaushik mentioned, and I'd like to mention, why are you here? How come you're here? Long week, you're busy, you're in a great city, you could be partying, you could be doing all sorts of things, but you're here. You're here. You're here for a reason that I think is very simple to state. The need to care is as powerful a human need as the need for care. We don't often think in those terms, but it's true. The need to care for somebody else, the need to care for another living being, is as powerful a human motivation as the need for care. Why else would you be here? So welcome. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're joining us. And if a lot of what I say sounds simple, it took a lot of work to make it this simple. In fact, the great scientist Albert Einstein reportedly said, if you can't say it simply, you don't understand it well enough. We're going to try to make this as clear as we possibly can. What is the peer support model? And all of the other factors around that particular topic. First, the elevator version of everything I'm about to say. And I'll be spending some time with you and we'll go over a lot of things, but you know what I mean by the elevator version, the really quick version. If you met somebody in an elevator on the fifth floor and they knew you took the training and you were going to the lobby, you were never gonna see them again, and they asked you what was the training about, there's a way to describe it in those few seconds. Love heals. Love heals. Kindness heals. It doesn't always cure. Curing and healing are different. Love heals. That's a wonderful notion. It's a wonderful notion in the rest of your life as well. That although we can't always cure people, unfortunately, we can often heal them spiritually, emotionally, socially. We can help them heal. It's not that we do it ourselves. We can help other people heal. That's the elevator version of everything I'm about to say. So, let's get started. You've all been here before. I don't mean in this room necessarily. But you've all been in a situation where caring for somebody or another living being, might be an animal companion, might be a person. You've all been here before. You've taken care of somebody, some living being. Somebody needed you for something. And you'll certainly be in that position here where somebody will need you. Somebody out there in this city will need you. And you'll be there. And you'll deliver well what they need. This isn't so complicated. This is about human relations. This is about the best that human beings can be. It's about the best that you and I can be. And that's what you'll learn. That's what the peer support model is, in my view. Somebody might ask you, well, what are your credentials for doing this work? Our society is obsessed with credentialed people. I'm surrounded in medical school and elsewhere with highly credentialed people, good at what they do, very bright. But you know what your credentials are for doing this work? Your heart is your credential. Your heart is your credential. That's the power of this work. Allow your heart to inform you. We'll say more about that. Let's take a bit to talk about our history. Take a little time to talk about the history. I went through a wonderful doctoral program in clinical psychology at UC Berkeley. Spent 4 years on that campus and loved it. When I finished, I got a postdoc, which is yet more education, believe it or not, at the Cancer Research Institute, the old Cancer Research Institute at UC Medical Center. The job that I got was defined as taking care of the non-physical needs of our patients. It was a 40-bed unit. Try to follow me in your mind. Imagine if you were me. Didn't have the experience, had some training, but not the experience. A little like this. It was a 40-bed unit, 40 seriously ill people. And I was supposed to be in charge of what was called the psychosocial needs of the patients, the non-physical needs. The docs and nurses were doing a very good job doing what they did with the physical end of things. They didn't have the time or the inclination or the training to deal with the interpersonal needs and the spiritual needs and psychological needs. So that's what I was supposed to do. For 40 people? I could have sat at the bedside of any one of those people all day long, given the power of what they were going through. They were all seriously ill. I didn't know what to do. And the medical director told me, he had no idea. He was a nice guy, but he had no idea what sort of job he was giving me. He said, by the way, the nurses are really stressed around here because people die a lot. Can you run support groups for the nurses also? And then he said, oh, and the interns, they come up through here and they take one look at this place and they're frightened out of their wits. And they're all real young and they're trying to figure out how to be doctors. So can you meet with them on a one-to-one basis and take care of them too? He was defining a job for perhaps a half a dozen people. Maybe a half dozen, maybe more. So I had a choice. I could either leave, but I wanted to stay. It was exactly the situation I wanted. Not the magnitude of it. But I wanted to be working. I wanted to use those skills I learned in clinical psychology, those counseling skills. I wanted to be able to use them to help people. What do? Do you leave? Do you stay and get burned out? You hope somehow to figure it out? One day, in the shower, I had an idea. That's what I wish for you. A great idea wherever you get, in the shower or wherever you get your great idea. I had a great idea. Volunteers. If I could get volunteers to come with me up to the Cancer Institute, I would train them. I would match them with patients. I would supervise the situation, and I would have some help. And maybe we could do this job. Well, it worked. It worked. It didn't take highly trained mental health professionals to do this work. In fact, in some ways, having volunteers who were regular folks was an advantage. Why was it an advantage? Because the patients saw somebody just like themselves. All those people in white coats, when you're really ill, can be really freaky to look at. Good people, wise people, bright people, but intimidating. I was setting up those patients with regular folks who were trained in the Shanti model of peer support, the same thing you're going through. And it worked. Not only work, but the university wanted to take credit for it. It was working so well. So they set up a conference with media people for me. They sent out a press release. Media people came. I didn't even know what a press release was. And all these people asked me a few questions, but one person really wanted to know what we were up to. A woman named Belva Davis, who was a real fixture in media around here for many years. She came to my house and she did a long interview and asked me wonderful questions about this new project. And finally she asked, well, what's the name of the new project? We were working so hard, there was no name. I never even thought of a name. So I said, excuse me, I'll get you some information. I had one page of information. I just needed to buy some time. I went into my office at home. I looked up at the shelf of my books. I saw a book on comparative religion. Right on the spine of the book, it said Shanti. And I knew what it meant. It was a Sanskrit word. a Sanskrit word, a Sanskrit language, that translates roughly as inner peace. A kind of inner peace that people sometimes have when they meet in just the right way. When you meet somebody from the heart. I walked out, I smiled, I handed her the sheet of paper that we had, and I said, the name of this project is Shanti Project. No committee meetings, no feasibility studies, nobody to ask for permission. It was wonderful. What wasn't so wonderful, that night all over Northern California was the name Shanti Project and my home phone number. Yeah. So now everybody who was seriously ill in Northern California knew where to find me. We got through it, it was okay. And she did, Velvet Davis did a wonderful story and they put it on television that night and the rest is history. And now it's nearly 43 years later. This June it'll be 43 years. Those first 7 years were interesting, from 1974 to approximately 1981. We were a cancer project only. That's what we did. We took care of people with cancer. We were the first cancer program where the volunteers were trained carefully to work with seriously ill people. There were other, the Cancer Society and other organizations had used volunteers prior to that. But we wanted to have trained volunteers, people who are trained in how to do this work in the peer support model. In 1981, I started getting calls. Got some even earlier than that, from medical colleagues of mine. We've got some patients here. They've got some kind of illness that we don't know. We're calling it gay cancer, because we don't know what else to call it. Can you guys help? I said, yeah, we're a cancer project, of course we can help. Oh, and by the way, they said, we don't know how it's spread. And right now, it's pretty much fatal. So we had a choice. Shanti had a choice. This was one of the most powerful moments in our history. Shanti had a choice. Do we stay a cancer project? We were doing good work and other communities were following our lead and trying to use our model. Or do we switch from cancer to this new illness that they were calling gay cancer? It was later called GRID. And later after that, it was called AIDS. What do you do? We presented that option to our volunteers. We presented that option to the people in our organization, our board, and others. And we made the switch. We made the switch from cancer to AIDS. We were the first community-based AIDS organization in the country. And I can say that with great authority because we already existed. We didn't have to start. We already existed. We just had to switch from one to the other. And many of us are still very, very proud of that switch and happy that it happened. So for many years, we took care during the roughest years of this epidemic, the 80s and 90s especially. We took care of people with a, not that it isn't a very serious illness now, it most certainly is. And the epidemic is certainly still going on. But we took care of people who are in very difficult situations. And then interestingly enough, we had an opportunity to come back and come full circle. And we started taking care of women, first women with breast cancer, now women with all forms of cancer. And we're doing that work as well. And then interestingly enough, we merged with PAWS. And we're taking care of humans, their animal companions, in a variety of ways that make a lot of us feel very grateful that we have the opportunity. So that's a thumbnail sketch of the history of the organization that you're about to join. there are many other programs around this country and elsewhere that have been modeled after Shanti, after the peer support model. And it's hard to know how many, but many. When we were running for a number of years a National Training Institute, we counted in the hundreds the number of organizations modeled after Shanti. That's what you've joined. I still remember our first client. He was my client. It's a man with Guillain-Barré disease. Anybody know Guillain-Barré? It's a neurological disorder. Gradually go through a paralysis. You go from feeling fine and everything works, and slowly things start shutting down. The muscles get paralyzed. And if the muscles around the heart and lungs get paralyzed, you die. So the real task is to keep people alive by keeping them on respirators. I don't know how they do it today, but in those days it was a rough go. And our first client was a man who had Guillain-Barré disease. And in the Christmas period of 1973 to New Year's 1974, I took care of him. And visited. And one of the interesting things I learned from Jim was that he said to me years later when we met for dinner, and he survived, by the way, he made it. He's still in this city, and I get emails from him every day, not personal emails. I'm on a list with everybody else, and he's active and alive and doing well. And he said to me at that dinner that we had, that was our kind of reunion dinner, I always knew when you were coming to visit. And I thought it was one of those California things. He was going to tell me he had paranormal abilities. He said, there was nothing like that. He said, you always wore those shoes with the squeaky soles, and I could hear you coming down the floor. I'm still wearing the same kind of shoes. Sometimes small things mean a lot. He made it very clear how happy he was when he heard those squeaks coming down the floor, down the hallway. Sometimes the smallest things mean an enormous amount. Try to remember that. Sometimes they have enormous consequences. Simple acts of kindness. Simple acts of kindness can have enormous consequences. You get somebody a book that they want. Give them a hug. You take them on a little drive somewhere. To you, it's little. You hardly did a thing. And then you find out later that it meant all the difference, made all the difference, made all the difference. So when we say that the Shanti model of peer support, what is a peer? If I asked you and we had a discussion, you'd say it's a friend, or you'd say it's somebody just like me. You'd come up with different ways of describing the peer support model. But it's different than other models. The peer support model is based on equality. It's based on the common human attributes that we all possess. Desire to be happy, an attraction to kindness. There are other models. There's the medical model. When you go to your doctor for a checkup or for whatever, that's not a peer support model. That's not based on equality. You don't sit there and let your doctor talk to you about his or her symptoms. He or she is the expert. You're there for whatever purpose you came, a yearly physical or some malady, some difficulty you're encounter, and they supply you with their best advice, with their expertise. That's not what we do. You're not an expert providing expert commentary to that other person. This is more like a friendship, except friendships are different, you know. They're equal in the sense that the other person's problems matter and your problems matter, and your happiness matters, and you share those kinds of things. The peer support model is based on your desire to be available to the other person, to listen to their story, to listen to their life, to see what's going on with them. And you may be talking about shared parts of your own life, you may be talking about yourself, but it's not that it's equal in that way. I like to say that you may be the difference between zero and one. You may be the difference between having one person there who really pays attention to that individual and having nobody. Sometimes there are people out there who have never been cared for by anybody in their lives. And then you show up. And you're willing to be there. And you're willing to talk to them. And you're willing to regard them as a worthwhile human being. Maybe the first time it ever happens. Difference between zero and one. I'll read you a story. Stories can be very powerful. We all come from cultures, by the way, that value stories. No matter what the diversity here in this room, if you go back thousands of years, you get to the same place. A bunch of people sitting around a campfire telling stories about the way the world worked, about who the enemies were and who the friends were, and who got married and who had kids and who died. Stories. Here's a story. A nurse took the tired, anxious serviceman to the bedside. "Your son's here," she said to the old man. She had to repeat the word several times before the patient's eyes opened. Heavily sedated because of the pain of his heart attack, he dimly saw the young uniformed Marine standing outside the oxygen tent. He reached out his hand. The Marine wrapped his toughened fingers around the old man's limp ones, squeezing a message of love and encouragement. The nurse brought a chair so that the Marine could sit beside the bed. All through the night, the young Marine sat there in the poorly lighted ward, holding the old man's hand and offering him words of love and strength. Occasionally, the nurse suggested that the Marine move away and rest for a while. He refused. Whenever the nurse came into the ward, the Marine was oblivious of her and of the night noises of the hospital. Now and then she heard him say a few gentle words. The dying man said nothing, only held tightly to his son all through the night. Along towards dawn, the old man died. The Marine released the now lifeless hand he'd been holding and went to tell the nurse. While she did what she had to do, he waited. Finally, she returned. She started to offer words of sympathy, but the Marine interrupted her. "Who was that man?" he said. The nurse was startled. "Well, he was your father," she answered. "No, he wasn't," the Marine replied. "I never saw him before in my life." "Then why didn't you say something when I took you to him?" "Well, I knew right away it had been a mistake, but I also knew he needed his son, and his son just wasn't there. When I realized he was too sick to tell whether or not I was his son, knowing how much he needed me, I stayed. The next time someone needs you, just be there. Stay." I mentioned how the peer support model is different than the medical model. It's different than the psychotherapist model. Have you ever seen a psychotherapist for some emotional challenge or relationship challenge? It's different than that. You go to their office, you talk, they listen, they offer some suggestions from time to time, so make some comments from time to time. But you're the one with the difficulty, they're the ones with the expertise. That's not what we do. That's not what we do. What we do is closer to friendship, but not quite. Because the other person is the focus. The other person is the focus. With a friendship, you would hope that both of you would share focus. It's also, the peer support model is also not like the clergy model, where you go to the clergy and they may tell you some scriptural selection that'd be useful in your life. But they have the expertise, and you come for advice. This is different. This is based on equality, the word equality is key to understanding the peer support model. It's not about fixing people. If you're the kind of person who always wants to fix people, be very careful with that inclination. That's not what we do. You fix machines, you don't fix people. It's not about fixing anybody. It's also not about helping, although the word helping gets used a lot, I use it a lot, it seems like such a decent word. But there's a way we use it that doesn't quite work. It's the way America sometimes helps developing nations. We fly over in helicopters and we drop food on the so-called natives, and then we fly away. We don't want to know them. We don't want to understand their lives. We help from a position of superiority and often arrogance. It's not about helping from a position of superiority. I can guarantee you one thing, as much as you don't want to believe this, one day you will be in the position of your client. May not be exactly the same illness, maybe something else. One day you will be in that position. It's about equality. It's not about fixing. It's not about helping from a position of superiority. It's about serving the other person. But serving, really wanting to serve that person. Wanting to serve their best interests as best you can, in the best way you know how. And it can be very simple. It can be very simple. I give you an example that I like offering. I had a surgery some years ago. It's been about 5 years now. I had hip replacement surgery, which is a very successful surgery. It turned out beautifully, but it actually is as gruesome as it sounds. Hip replacement, yep. That's what they do. And I was in the hospital for only 3 days. And my wife, Cindy, slept in the hospital all those days. And she wondered at one point, she was essentially playing the role of Shanti Peer Support Volunteer. I wanted her there so that they didn't make a mistake. Sometimes mistakes happen. I didn't want to be the victim of one. She saw that I was sleeping a whole lot, and when I woke up, she said, "Are you hurting a lot?" And I said, "No, I'm not." She said, "Then why are you sleeping?" I said, "It must be the medication they're giving me." So the nurse came in, and they were about to give me some more of those little yellow pills that knocked me out. And Cindy said, "Does he need such high-dose pain meds? He said that he's not in any pain. Maybe we could cut back on the pain meds and he could be awake more." And the nurse said, and I always remember her response, she was a fine person, I'm sure very skilled, but she said, "Oh, we could cut back on it. That's not a problem." And so they did. And I stayed awake more. And I was having a much better experience because there wasn't a lot of, was not a lot of pain. And it was great seeing Cindy, and it was great feeling like I had done something to get rid of the distress of having a malfunctioning hip. But to this day, I wonder, why did we have to figure it out? Why were we the ones who had to figure it out? They would have knocked me out for days. Not because they were bad people, but because they just thought that was the right thing to do. And she made one simple suggestion. Maybe you, to your client, will make one simple suggestion that will make all the difference. It doesn't have to be about their medical condition. It can be about their, something else in their lives. One simple observation, something easy. Okay, skills. Everybody wants skills. Everybody's feeling like they don't have enough skills. I don't know what I'm doing. I need skills. We live in a skill-obsessed culture, as if skills are the only game in town. But it matters. And there are three I'd like to offer you. that will make all the difference. If you get great at these three, you'll do this work beautifully. Actually, I believe you'll do this work beautifully anyway. But you'll do it particularly well if you learn three things. First, listening from the heart. Listening from the heart. Listening to the other person as if they were the focus of a meditation. How do we normally listen? Well, if you and I were having lunch somewhere, and I was talking, you'd sort of be listening, but you'd probably be thinking about lots of other things, like what you were going to say next, or where you were going to go next, or who you were going to see later that day. Listening from the heart means really focusing on what the other person is saying. Listening from the heart. Second, speaking from the heart. Speaking your truths honestly, what you know to be true, not something you read in a book once. Speaking from the heart with kindness. And then last, acting from the heart. Acting from the heart. It can be small, as I said, it can be a small thing. In fact, the biggest thing you do for the other person is your presence. Your compassionate presence, showing up, listening from the heart, speaking from the heart, acting from the heart. And if three things are too many skills to master, and you had to pick one, pick the first one, listening from the heart. People go through their entire lives never really being listened to. Trust me, I understand that one. Not because it happened to me, but because I've met people like that who've said that to me. Nobody ever listened to me the way you listen to me. How do I listen to you? All I'm doing is focusing. Yeah, but nobody else ever did. Listening from the heart, speaking from the heart, acting from the heart. Many wonderful people have come through here, through the training and through their work at Shanti over almost 43 years now. And I remember many people, but one person who I'd like to introduce you to, at least in theory, is a woman named Micaela, who was here for a number of years doing great work. And all her clients loved her, and the rest of the staff loved her, and she was just one of these really likable, bright, likable people. And at one point, I was studying what the characteristics were of Shanti's exemplary volunteers, the people who our clients said were wonderful. I want to know what they did. I want to try to figure it out so I could teach it to everybody else. So I asked her, what do you do that's so special, that makes the clients so grateful? And she insisted that she didn't do anything special at all. I said, well, you gotta tell me what you do. Try to figure it out. At first she was embarrassed, and then she went home and she came up to me a couple of weeks later and she said, I thought about your question about what I do, and I do three things and may be useful for you to know. I show up. A lot of people don't. I pay attention. A lot of people don't. And I care. A lot of people don't. Those sound very simple, but let's try to go through them. When she said she shows up, she meant she really shows up. All of her shows up, not just her body shows up. She really focuses. She pays attention. Again, focus. She really pays attention to the other person. And she cares. She feels it. She feels it. She feels what they're going through. It's called empathy. She feels it. Show up, pay attention, and care. If she was here, I'm sure she would tell you a story or two about working with Shanti clients. But I have her here on audio, which is somewhere. And what I'd like to do is play Micaela in her own words. And then see what your reaction is to what she says. This is Michaela working with her client, Richard. Simple. She's a trained massage therapist, so she offered that skill. She put together the music because she knew that that was the music that he loved. You may love some other kind of music. So you get your music when your time comes. And what did she do? She was there for him. Love heals. Love heals. She reconnected him with the music that he loved for a lifetime, but had fallen out of love with because of the illness. That was the perfect present. The perfect present. That music was the perfect present. You know, when we give people presents, most of the time it's kind of a nice try. You do your best, and you hope they like it. But once in a while, you hit it perfectly. The perfect present. That was the perfect present. You don't have to give people massages. As I said, she was a trained massage therapist. If somebody asks you to do something you're uncomfortable with, of course you don't do it. If you have any questions, call back here and ask. But she was able to offer a skill that she had developed, and it worked. And she was able to offer him the perfect present. Sometimes you'll be caring for somebody much different than you. The whole issue of diversity comes up. Diversity in all its forms, cultural diversity, age difference, racial difference, sexual preference differences, all manner of differences, you name it. Do you ever have a relationship with somebody that started out poorly but ended up beautifully, so that if you gave up on it initially, you never would have had a really good relationship in your life? People have such experiences. I remember a situation, a man I cared for at the Cancer Institute years ago, who was labeled a difficult patient. Nobody liked this guy. Everybody talked about him as hard to deal with, impossible to relate to. And by the way, if you're ever in a hospital, don't get yourself labeled difficult patient, because it goes in the chart and everybody else reads it. So even people who have never met you don't like you. That's what happened to this guy. He had no chance. So finally they asked me if I would visit and spend some time with him. So I entered his room and sat down, and first thing he said to me is, "You passed." I said, "Passed what?" He said, "You passed my test." I said, "What test was that?" He said, "You sat down. Nobody else sits down around here. They all come racing into my room. They ask me how I'm doing. They don't really want to know. They mess with the IV bottle. They do a few other things that I don't understand, and then they leave. They make 2-minute U-turns at the foot of my bed and split. And I'm supposed to be grateful." I said, "Well, I've got more time than they do." He said, "Yeah, really? What kind of doctor are you?" I said, "I'm a psychologist." He said, "Oh, now they think I'm crazy." "No, they don't think you're crazy. They're just having trouble relating to you. Maybe I can help." He said, "You want to help?" I said, "Absolutely." He said, "Get me some orange juice." I said, "No, I mean, I want to help with the problems you're having with the staff." He said, "You said you wanted to help. If you really want to help, get me some orange juice." I could have gotten him orange juice before that doctoral program I took. But I got up and I wandered out and I got him orange juice. I got him a quart and a glass. He didn't even use the glass. He went right for the cord. Drank nearly the whole thing, it seemed. I said, "What's going on?" He said, "That chemotherapy they've given me makes me thirsty. They told me it would make me thirsty, but I never knew anybody could be this thirsty. And then you come along after I've been pushing that buzzer near my bed, you know that buzzer near the bed in the hospital? I've been pushing it for half an hour, nobody showed up. Of course nobody showed up, nobody wanted to go in his room. And then you ask, and I'm dying of thirst, and you ask what you can do. What do you think I'm gonna say? Get me something to drink. He was right. He was absolutely right, and I told him so. So we sat and we talked, and he was a difficult guy, there's no doubt about it. But finally I said to him, look, maybe we can meet with staff. Maybe we can get something going where you're not so difficult for them to care for, and they're not so difficult for you to relate to. He said, that's okay, I don't mind, I don't need to be rough all the time, I don't mean to be, I just don't want to be treated like some imbecile. And it worked. It worked. He went from somebody who was extremely hard to deal with to somebody who was, well, he never was joyful. It never was easy, but at least it was possible. And he deserved the best shot we could give him. He had a very serious illness that he eventually died of. He was somebody a lot different. His personality, and we're talking about diversity, his personality was a whole lot different than mine and a whole lot different than most of the other folks there. But he was a basically decent man who just wanted to be taken seriously. Diversity is an interesting topic. The last thing I would want is to be taking care of people just like me. I know what I want. I know what I think. I'd much rather learn from people different than I am. Learn about their lives, learn about what they care about, learn about their upbringing. Be curious. Be curious about people who are much different than you are. Now, we're in California, so we need some bumper stickers. Some, what I call bumper stickers, things that are easy to remember. I mentioned the first one right off the bat. The need to care is as powerful a human need as the need for care. A couple of others. The experience of being cared for may benefit the patient as much as anything else that happens to them. Just the experience of being cared for. When you go into hospitals, when you talk to people who have some kind of serious ailment, and you talk to them about their experiences with caregivers, they almost always talk about the one or two or three people who really care, who really get it, who really take them seriously. Love heals, kindness heals. The experience of being cared for may benefit the patient as much as anything else that happens to them. And then the last one, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. People don't care how much you know. You can be Einstein, and it doesn't matter. It does not matter unless they know you care. Unless they really know you care. Okay, one last story. A story that I've asked, for years I've asked Kaushik to read because he gets through it better than I do. It's about a young man in a cab and an old woman going to a hospice. And the reason I don't read it is it reminds me too much of my mother who went to a hospice in a situation just like this. So you don't need to see me water up, you might as well listen to Kaushik tell you the story. Your client may not be going to a hospice. You may be taking care of people who are doing well. Chances are high that you're supporting people who are living their lives and doing well. But the reverse is also possible. One thing I can tell you, And it's a quote from a writer named James Baldwin, who should never be forgotten. A great writer named James Baldwin, who said, "The moment we cease to hold each other, the moment we break faith with one another, the sea engulfs us and the light goes out." Thank you for joining us at Shanti. For 43 years, we've been helping the most vulnerable people in this area to prevent the light from going out. It's great to have you aboard.